So this week we're going to delve into emotion and the brain. And actually we're going to be talking not only about emotion, which is really kind of, you know, defined in terms of, you know, a lot of neuroscience and psychological research as the bodily expression, you know, in response to stimuli, you know, in our environment that can elicit emotional responses. And also we'll talk about feelings, you know, which are really the perceptions of those bodily expressions of emotions. So emotions, you know, are actions or movements, right? Many of them public, you know, visible to others as they occur in the face, in the voice, in specific behaviors. That was a definition provided by a neuroscientist named Antonio Damasio, who has this somatic marker theory about, you know, both emotional expression and the felt aspects, the mapping of these changes, you know, in response to stimuli that can provoke emotions. These are called actually emotionally competent stimuli, things that can actually generate changes in our bodies and brains, you know, in terms of how we're responding. And these, when these changes in the body, how the body is, you know, reacting and responding to stimuli, are mapped in the brain in specific regions of the brain, specific limbic structures. We're gonna see actually, you know, typically cortical regions of the brain. They are perceived and felt, you know, as actual, you know, aspects of, you know, our feelings, like what we're feeling. So, you know, it's interesting how this topic, you know, emotion and feeling, you know, is something that, you know, for in back in the 19th century anyway, was actually, you know, thought to be, you know, quite ripe for scientific investigation. In fact, one of the, you know, most famous scientists of all, Charles Darwin, actually wrote a book called The Expression of the Emotions in Man and Animals, which was published in 1872, in which he, like, noted, you know, the similarity of emotional expression in terms of facial expression, postural adjustments, et cetera, you know, across all humans, and also across, you know, various animal species, how there was something sort of, you know, consistent about emotional expression, which I think is really interesting. And, you know, certainly he did too. And, you know, it sort of is a key to the kind of regulatory nature of emotions. You know, they actually are, you know, responses that are essential and, you know, helpful, useful, beneficial, you know, for getting us typically back into some sort of, you know, homeostatic or allostatic balance. So we'll be talking a lot about this. You know, actually, there's an image that I put up here of, you know, there's a famous physiologist who explored, you know, the sort of architecture of facial expression, you know, by placing, you know, powerful electrodes on the surface of the face and, you know, stimulating various branches, you know, of the facial nerve, which, you know, can drive, you know, many expressions. There's at least, you know, 42 different muscles, you know, underneath your face that can drive all sorts of fascinating and interesting, you know, kinds and, you know, socially meaningful sorts of expressions. And he would take that electrode and, you know, basically reveal, you know, the electric grid basically that ran, you know, the musculature of facial expression. And Darwin used a lot of Duchenne's, you know, kind of images in his 1872 book. Of course, in the 20th century, you know, the behaviorists were not thrilled about the idea of, you know, emotion, and particularly not feeling. You know, that seemed kind of, you know, complicated, messy, you know, hard to assess, you know, with purely, you know, kinds of behavioral sorts of responses. So it sort of fell out of favor. But, you know, recently there's been a lot of interest in, you know, the stimuli, both internal and external, that can provoke, you know, emotional responses in our bodies and in our nervous systems, you know, which are the emotional expressions, right, which is the emotion. And then the mapping or the, you know, the distribution through specific perceptual networks in the brain that support our felt experiences of those emotional expressions. So we're going to talk this week about both emotion and feeling and the brain.